everyone, particularly everyone participating in Catalyst Week. So this is not just a discussion for us, but a discussion for everyone. So I'll start it off, but really I want, if anyone wants to join in and start participating with this panel at any moment, do not hesitate. I guess there's so many ways to start this, and I promised Luke that we wouldn't go into Deleuzean theory here. So, I guess I'll frame it this way, and I think this is really wonderful in the context of last year's lecture series, which was framed around play, right? Particularly Huizinga's issue of or ideas around play and the type of work that is produced through play. And what I see happening out here is certainly playful, and this is not to dismiss anything. I think it's a very rigorous kind of play. It was brought up by Eric at the beginning of Perry's lecture, and without a doubt, every single person up here is interrogating the space of representation, which I think is what was on the table for this whole week. Without a doubt, there's a space. Sometimes it's really abstract, and sometimes it's very immediate when one thinks of the material diagrams that you're working on. But this is the space of representation that we're all working within, right? And there's a certain amount of playfulness in there too, but a rigorous playfulness. There's a set of protocols, as Perry mentioned. And I guess what I want to ask is, or first say is that this space of representation is absolutely without a doubt an active agent in all of your work, and all the work that everyone's engaged in out in the courtyard too, be it underneath or right on the surface, right? And I'm wondering when you know, especially in your work, Perry, where we just saw, there is definitely an element of playfulness, right? But there are choices along the way, and sometimes there's an intuitive choice made, and sometimes there's no overt choice made. It's not that anyone is surrendering any of their capability or their authorship within any of this in this act of the playfulness. And I'm just wondering, for everyone, when is it conscious or is it intuitive? How does one work and operate in this space of representation as you move through these projects? Because they happen through time and slowly in almost every case. They're not quick.
Luke told me that he can't stand silence, so I'm waiting. Yeah,
good. Terrible, break the silence.
Terrible tolerance for silence. How does it participate? How does representation participate in the work we're doing within the workshops? Or are you talking about
In your own work or in the work upstairs? There's decisions being made along the way, right?
Yeah.
It's not that we're just doing this for just to generate.
I mean, after. Like the degree of illusionistic sort of space that I think you use, I feel so flat-footed in the way that I actually use images, because usually I'm using images. I'm not so much or very often making images. So it's always about producing some kind of a comparative kind of space, and about using the book is this sort of medium that makes those comparisons possible and unfolds them over time. So I don't know. I think that the work that we do has a much higher degree of utility to it, which I think is distinct from maybe some of the things that we're seeing develop here.
Right.
So that would be my opening again. I'm a flat-footed utilitarian. That's what I'm saying.
Flat-footed utilitarian. I
was thinking about this because I think there's a spectrum, right? And I think that you're working right directly on the space of the final representation, right on the medium itself.
Yeah.
And almost second to that, I would put Ludovica, who is the material itself is with the space, the material behavior, the physical nature of that material, right?
And I guess coming back to your question, I think there is a moment in which, because I think we are also speaking where, let's say, intuition or actually, you know, kind of our decision as a designer, mm-hmm. enter into the process at some point. I think I understood that basically that's what your question.
Precisely.
I think what I can understand, I can reply regarding what is actually happening here during the Catalyst workshop. I think it's a kind of, it's a very kind of magic moment when you, at some point, you see the students finally, that they enter into the logic of the system. It's something, I can speak about, the experience that I have here, so it's something very, it's like, they are doing this Fayotto, kind of variation with threads and so on. It's kind of, it's fun, it's great, but in the beginning, they were kind of, okay, what we are actually doing? Are we doing threads? And, in the beginning, the process is kind of long, and so there is a moment in which you start to see in their eyes a kind of, okay, oh gosh, this is actually, it's doing something.
Is this true?
Particular for me. I don't know. Maybe I thought, this is what I see. Probably
it's my beaming in your section.
So I just like you see that they're starting to say, okay, I think actually requires a lot of, let's say, effort in the beginning, because it's like using a tool but understanding how the logic of the tool works without really foreseeing the result.
Right.
And I think this is the play also, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a rigorous play, but it's still play. Something that, let's see.
Okay.
maybe something that all of us can talk about in one way or another, because I think it's running through all of it, especially with this question of play is collage. And I think collage, having two very young children, this is one of the first ways in which we learn about representation. And it always involves some kind of play, because things have been cut up. They're of different materials, different sources, different origins. They have different... kid doesn't say, oh, they have different formal properties, but they do. And you somehow begin to bring these things together into a world where they become more than the pieces and parts of which they arose from. And I mean, I don't know if you guys want to pick up on this or not, but I think each of us in one way or another is using different kinds of techniques of collage. Maybe we can differentiate between collage and montage of the ways in which you reveal seams or conceal seams, the ways in which you imply temporality through layering and the layering both of depth literally and then also of depth illusory. And do we want to pick it up? Some like something we can all jump on?
Well, the first thing that popped into my head was actually something derogatory that somebody said to me, is that I don't know if it was a client or a contractor said that like architects are like the world's biggest scrapbookers.
Biggest
scrapbookers.
Scrapbookers.
Like, we take other people's stuff and just sort of paste them together, right? Okay. And it was a really kind of backhanded way to talk about the lack of operation and agency that we actually have with things, which I completely reject. But I like the idea that the space like that you're interacting in and that you're leveraging is the space of operation, mm-hmm. right? One of the things we've been talking about in our group is where is the actual piece? Mm-hmm. Like, is it in the tumble? Is it in the capture? Is it in the manipulation? Is it in the operation on it after we manipulate it? Once we start thinking about that surface as flat and that all of those things are architectural and all are representational kind of at the same time, I think that there is some real strength and hope in that idea of collaging. Mm-hmm. Like, one of the things I wondered about your drawing is, you ever dig in them? Like, it seems like they build and build and build. Do you ever go back and like kind of, there was something underneath that you get to, so you actually are physically like cutting back to something that was there before?
Normally the erasure
has
some sort of qualities of that, yeah.
But it seems like they're so kind of thick and plastic in a way, and I mean that in a good way, and there's so much kind of time and depth and space in them that like, what's uncollaging something, or is there a kind
dig-lage.
Of... dig-lage.
Yeah.
Right?
Very cool.
Can I ask a question for that?
Certainly.
Which
don't think of it, what, depends on what kind of work I'm trying to do. So I'm interested in becoming increasingly discretionary about the ways in which techniques are deployed, representational techniques. The assertion is that it's simply easier, better to work on certain things in certain ways and not in other ways. So, but the drawings that Blair was referring to, I think the kind of thickened ones, I don't think of as collages at all. They have the appearance, they're sort of metaphorical collages, but they don't have any of the formal aspirations of something like collage. Those drawings have to do with allowing me various forms of commitment and understanding about ideas. Hunches are equally valued to things which I'm certain about. Figuration is valued at the same time as an ethereal sort of piece of poetry that I read that might be triggering something that's nearby at hand. So I think of those as having mobile and temporally active contours of relationships, relational assemblies within them. The collages don't have, for me, collage typically does not have that. The scene is the place in which the transactions occur in those pieces of work because the families of communication are different from borrowed imagery to figuration to indexical marks and so on. They're way less distinct in terms of collage. Something like the Z objects, which are just an initial, you know, sort of a hunch about things that might have a kind of curiosity about them, but might begin to probe or entangle things that we take for granted, default conditions. Those might be a collage at the level of trying to augment the city, but they're not collagic in terms of the work that they do or the kind of range of territories that they try to inscribe. They're not even representationally active. There are lots of projects like that around that, you know, sort of have an idea about something. The vertical surfaces have a similar sort of quality. You know, I wonder, just curiosity, could I use representation to probe something, to try to draw out, to discover what something might discuss? But it's funny, the question about play, I mean, a lot of people say that I'm not a control freak, but when I make a drawing, there's not a lot of play in the drawing. They're very, very disciplined. I rehearse those as design conditions, yeah. As they're very, very specific.
I would like
the use of the font and where the figure is in relationship to that and what that constellation of things is trying to communicate as potential spatially and so on. They have a quality of sort of improvisation and kind of intuition and so on. They're very too tightly and rationally, logically structured, which is a bit of a problem. But I then try to mine the latent potential, the things that I don't intend. There's a discussion about the way I drew the figure begins to suggest orbital patterns and structures of flight and operations, which the marks didn't intend at all. And do those have potential? That's where the play might come out, in the latent capacities of things, the quiet, the nascent, the discoverable things. But they're not, they're really tight, actually. But I'm not afraid to put whims into play and hunches and leave things in drawings, scraps of parts that seems sort of interesting. Might be formally interesting, might be compositionally necessary, might be thinking about the drawing in an exhibition that might be useful for the drawing that doesn't have much to do with the content of what I'm trying to work on. So lots of, they're repositories of visual thinking.
I would like to add to that and make a very clear distinction too, that scrapbooking is very different than collaging,
yeah,
right?
Very much so.
Collaging is a very rigorous operation, right? And it's not just throwing a bunch of stuff together and calling it a day. There's processes of erasure and time and duration and addition that is involved with any collage. So it's a very different kind of operation.
That's what it was mean.
Yeah. What's that?
That's why it was mean.
Yeah. Yeah, and I guess, and what you're talking about, Perry, is that it may appear playful or whatnot, but when you're thinking about this, you're thinking about it in a very abstract space of representation itself too. This is helping you guide, and you're making, it's helping you guide decisions along the way,
sure,
from one to the next,
sure,
which is why I think you're saying, yeah, it's not collage at all.
I don't think of it that way,
yeah,
but what I do think is, and I think Michael was pointing to it, is that the collage is helpful,
mm-hmm,
in the sense that it allows difference to come together.
Mm-hmm.
And that's like a curiosity, yeah, cabinet. It allows you to deal with things which are dissimilar from one of the things or objects or conceptual structures or whatever. So I think of collage more in those terms, mm-hmm, less in terms of specific technique. But I liked the kids, you know, bringing, you know, really alternative worlds. They're the carrot,
is a hat for a miniature snowman. How can the carrot and snow, how can those discuss one another? How's that possible? So I think collage is super, super helpful in the sense, a curiosity cabinet that allows things that normally don't, you know, sort of not in the same territory, they might coexist.
And I wonder if also, kind of following your lecture tonight, it seemed that there was these moments of intense control and then the desire to lose yourself or to shift what you thought you'd already nailed in terms of too much control or too much expertise. Yeah. And then maybe collage in terms of its history with somebody like Picasso and Braque and Gris is not, mm-hmm. not the appropriate term, but the kinds of juxtapositions of things that you wouldn't have put into places had you not brought them into the same space that is maybe closer to surrealism, and I don't know if that's why you're involved in the surrealist book that you described, but there seems to be that aspect active in your work, that things come in. I saw themes would come back again, the dazzle camouflage would come back again, and it had a different meaning and a different relationship the next time it came around. Also a series of different kinds of ways of rigorously controlling arcs through centers and radii, which at one level were almost geometric descriptions, but then took on an entire world of figuration and leapt from that into something else. I'm wondering if this has something maybe to do with Andrea's lecture last night about analogies, mm-hmm. about a space where one draws analogies and begins to make combinations that were not available unless you had those multiple notations together.
Hmm. Analogic thinking is one of the 14 design methods, let's say, so things can behave like other things, or the mantle of sorrow, the sky is crying, that we begin to composite things or collage things that couldn't otherwise. Hard to coexist.
Well, I mean, I've been amazed to see your drawings. I think they really reflect a way of thinking that is so intense and complex and like a really an exploration in different realms, you know, from the practical to the to the celestial, to the world of zoomorphic forms, is what drawing is about. Drawing, I think, is a way to explore the thoughts that come to mind, and the thoughts come from experience, from seeing things, from participating to everyday life, from reading books, and from everything that somehow is part of this experience. So, drawing is notation, is a diary in a way to me, at least for us architects, which we tend not to consider drawing the final work, but drawing is like a bridge that brings us towards another kind of territory. Of course, I like to design the bridges as well, you know. So the drawing becomes, in a way, a micro architecture, something which we have total control. We can say, this is what I like to do, and it's very different than what you can do then in the real world sometime, you know, or unless maybe you do it 20 years later or 30 years later. But, going back to the idea of analogy, I think it's true. We collect thoughts, and the thoughts, any thoughts, either this red cable or this microphone or this corner, can be the seed for an analogy in another field, for another practical application, for another invention, something that relates to our work in that moment. Clearly, accumulating information, selecting information, putting it in the storage of our mind, putting them down in the drawing and so on, create that possibility of going there and pick something up and going there and pick something else up. And the moment that the project, I'm still talking as an architect, come into play, that's the moment in which you somehow forget everything at the same time you put everything that you knew in the design, even if it's a long process and so on. Now the question is how this analogical thought get transferred and what are the goals of this final product. Because I can think about this microphone and think that this could be a great skyscraper in the middle of a city. You know, and maybe this is a great IMAX movie, whatever they call it, and so on. And maybe this is a way to discharge trash, you know, everywhere. And I think it's great because this could give a lot of great music to the town that generally doesn't have really a sound, you know, in itself. And I can go on and on and on. And then I say, okay, so I make this a piece of architecture and I draw the tower that looks like a microphone. Okay, it's justified. At the same time, as an architect, I think, wait a moment, I have 3,000 years of history of architecture. You know, people that have thought architecture all the time, they have really thought about proportion and bodies and the way a floor and the ceiling and you know, and the wind and the fenestration and the landscape and the place and blah, blah, blah. What do I do? Do I put that away or I try to integrate into this? Or maybe I say, okay, this is a great analogy, but I use the language of architecture, or at least part of the great part of the language in architecture, in order to continue the text. It's like if I am a writer, it's not that I invent a new language all the time, you know, I may develop a language, I may pick up and so on. You know, I go back now and read Latin authors and I found them extremely modern. You know? I read Seneca, I don't know, I read Lucretius. And you think, oh, Lucretius. Well, Lucretius was, you know, it was a scientist. You
sure,
know?
Maybe. Things are swerving.
Yeah, and so, I mean, even if I have to write something that is scientific and literary, maybe Lucretius is the best, is a better example than, I don't know, looking into some Nobel Prize that is also a writer. Who knows? So, I want to, and nullify, I just say, the sense of chronology, you know? I like to, don't think about chronology, think about what is something that has value for me. I know, we are in this auditorium. This was designed by Stephen Knoll. Stephen Knoll is not like a traditionalist, you know? But he did a very traditional place in many ways, you know? But is, do you feel comfortable? Does it work? Is that something that maybe you know, we can continue in some list of this tradition we develop, or we need to do this as the auditorium? Or I mean, I think the research is important, but at the same time, we all have to check the. I think the result of this research with also something that is not only research that is already done, that is already being explored, has been already studied and developed. So yeah. I like this tension between the two things more than just going one direction.
I want to come back to this idea of precedent and research and whatnot in just a bit. But before I do that, because I have another issue related to this, is there anything, any questions anyone would like to ask? Yeah. New or pertaining to the conversation that's going on? Yeah, Savannah?
Asking everyone
yes.
The question except for me.
I mean, there's some difficulty here because sometimes the question that you're exploring might be very rule-based or Blair, some of your thoughts today from your lecture were more goal-oriented, you know, working towards a particular product, but you still at some point
Sure.
Yeah. So I'm interested in those more practical questions about how are you orchestrating your work?
You're all looking at me. I'm thinking about a good response for that.
Do you want me to take a quick whack?
Take a whack at it, yeah.
I mean, this is a nice question. For me, the ultimate target right now is to figure out what the scope of architecture might be. So to try to figure out, and I try to auger into the scope question at four primary levels. What are the cultural roles of things that I might do, we might do? What are the disciplinary roles? What are the institutional realms? Because a lot of us teach. So what's the role of the work within that realm? And then what are the personal roles? So I'm interested in the scope, how to determine exactly this question. What responsibilities, what can be taken on, what might be discussed through a speculative piece of work or a drawing or an urban proposal or a set of whatever. So this is where the buck stops, and it's actually quite hard to figure out what the realms should be, what could be discussed, how to figure out how to discuss, how to structure those things. And then with respect to my interest in cultural durability and the cultural imaginary, trying to work the scope relative to those two conditions. So it's a very, very difficult, for me it's really hard. It's always a situational decision for me. So if I'm hungry for breakfast and I decide to have cereal, situationally I go to the refrigerator, I open it, and I get the milk out and pour it on the cereal. There's a set of protocols and a set of demeanors, decorum. If I go the next morning and a cat jumps out of the refrigerator and onto my chest, now there's another set of discussions and another set of potentials within the scope of that experience.
Be a cold cat. That,
yeah,
cold cat.
So that I try to really work out within the situation in which I'm structuring the work or the approach, what kinds of things are legitimate or might be worked on the one hand. On the other hand, what might be discovered and what might lie outside of my ability to see what's within that scope. So I try to be very, when I work, I try to be really specific in terms of what I'm trying to work on. A relational drawing is very specific. It's not trying to deal with social and political conditions and cultural durability. So I try to be increasingly discretionary about what's in the field and what's not in the field. That's the end of the line for me. That's the hardest question. I grew up with programs and sites. You know, a library, and you're going to work on the site in Hoboken, and it's going to be 60,000 square feet, and you're going to have 300 parking spaces, and so on. That's the way the scope was determined. I had great teachers, a great, you know. That to me has nothing to do really with the cultural scope of work. So this is a really, really fine question. It's the hardest.
Yeah, it's a great question.
It's an incredibly hard question to know how to, there's no instrumental, yeah, I do this and I, you know, there's boxes that I check and categories that are there.
I would say I'm not at all goal-oriented either, yeah. In a way. I don't set forward and say, I'm going to design a house that is made out of garbage and this is my agenda. And I think it's a good answer, and I would say that a lot of what I think that we're working with and dealing with is very much discursive. Like when I get a program, I've been gainfully employed as an architect before as well.
Yeah.
I've had things I've had to do. I see those as limits, as constraints, and then I begin to probe inside that space.
Sure.
You unpack them. You begin to work back and forth to find opportunities that the preconceived notion of what's put forward by a client or somebody or a program or a material in our case. Begins to push back with, and then actually be willing to kind of give over to what you learn from the process, right? Mm-hmm. So when I'm drawing or when we're making or doing things like that, it's completely a call and response. I'm not trying to impose and I'm trying to pull out. And it's funny, we were walking yesterday back to the car and I was feeling really self-conscious because a lot of the drawing I've been doing lately has been really representational, right? Mm-hmm. Like I'm drawing the thing. It's depictive, yeah. It's like, that's what it's going to look like. This is how it's going to play out. It's to describe to somebody else what's going on. It's very much conscious of the reader as much as it is of the drawing itself. But I don't know that that's
like I don't really think about drawing that way as an agenda. It's just a means to an end. So the project itself is very much in the foreground. So with paper, paper behaves in a certain way. So what do you do with that? How do you leverage it? How do you sort of do a kind of judo as opposed to a fight, kind of redirect that energy in a productive way? And that's sort of the way a project works in my head as well.
I always use that. I use that judo example. Judo's I just used it the other day. The difference between efficiency and efficacy, right?
Right.
You want to be. You want to have the efficacy.
Efficacy. Right. Yeah.
It's not about the efficiency. Mm-hmm. In my answer to this question, it's really two things to consider. One is the long project of what you're working on over years, mm-hmm. and we make problems for ourselves. And at least my partner and I, we hope to try to find the way that those problems have a disciplinary reference either to history or to an issue that's going on today within the discipline of architecture. And for instance, we've been trying to do things with the difference between diseño and colore. Now that's about as old, that's at least 500 years old, if not more. Or if you saw some of the things that came up 2 days ago in my talk, the relationship between abstraction and realism, or questions of symmetry, or ornament versus decoration. And these have long histories that are big problems that are not just our problems, but have a development that has been traced back that can be then pushed forward. So when we work on a project, what the process is one of those things, or two of those things, is on the table, and usually it's addressed to what we did with it, the project before that, or the one before that, and it's somehow now, okay, how do we begin to develop that further? But the other part of the question is just, what's your process? And that's a very tricky thing, and it involves a lot of contingencies. There is an analogy that I'll make to the British artist Bridget Riley, because I've always actually quite admired her process. Was it? And if you know how she works, I don't know if you guys know how she works, she basically, within little kind of graph sheets, lays out kind of in text and in numbers and in little diagrams, kinds of systems of ways of behavior of geometry. This produces a little kind of sketch. She hands it then to an assistant. That assistant paints the painting. She doesn't paint the painting. That assistant paints the painting, and then she sits back and asks herself, is it making my eyes vibrate? Is it making my body resonate? Am I having an aesthetic affect to that thing? And by distancing herself from the actual act of being the person that touches the paint, it puts her in a different relationship to the thing that she's evaluating aesthetically. And if it's working, awesome. On to the next project. If not, back to the systems board, the drawing board, the graphing board, the notational board, the way in which she mixes all this stuff together. And so for me, at least, I know that distancing mechanism is really important. Sometimes it can be time. Sometimes it can be as simple as having a partner that you work with. For me, that's been incredibly important because it's another eye, another person that doesn't see it the way you do, and you can bounce things off. This is a little bit what I think Blair and Mark were talking about earlier today. And so, for other people, it's really how do you throw a grain of sand in the oyster? How do you mess up the system at a certain point to get that distance to evaluate it a little bit differently and to pull yourself from, sometimes we get so close and so intimate that it's almost impossible to judge.
I mean, it's a good question, Adam. I've realized that things like program are a kind of discipline, there are disciplinary problems and continuities that Michael talked about, for example. But I've in some of the work, the program seems to be culturally available and seems to be a place in which we might orient, might be a, begin to structure things that have to do with the content of the work. And in some of the cases, I used program or invented programmatic thinking to try to stimulate certain conversations, like in the Steph Technology Garden, for example, the inversion of the kind of trophy room realm, the fat Texas guy who sits with a cigar and sort of chrome boots, straps and so on, trying to invert that to try to put the birds into a domain in which things like taxidermy and collection and memorabilia and so on, to try to reverse trend there. So the naming of the program, the Steph Technology Garden, does work then relative to the interest in artificial and natural systems and human animal dialogues and so on. In that case, in the island, the programs are sort of invented to carry the content of the work in a really specific way. So landings for mythical sea creatures that combine with these parasitic biological labs that are gathering information from kelp harvesting processes and so on, the conflation of instrumentality and science and sort of mythologies and folklore. Those things are multiplied officers' garden, officers' headquarters, which have to do with politicizing the controlling mechanism of this military installation and so forth. Those things just allow me to touch, in many cases, the content, the kind of ideas, is one of the key ways to structure ways that the content of the work can be available, can gain communicative potential at different levels of register and resolution and granularities and so on. It's not always the case. Like the bleached out house won't have anything to do with program, will be inconsequential, really. It'll have to do with erasure, recoding, reflexive objects, which try to reinvigorate an empty condition. Won't have anything to do with program. So it varies. It varies from work to work. But they're also pithy for me to name test tube berms. They're pithy. They gather up lots of stuff. They're stuff technology gardens. You know, circuses of migratory wind. They're like characters. They're a playwright that is trying to, you know, gather up a lot of stuff. They do work for me sometimes.
I was struck by this aspect in your presentation, because there would be one of your drawings, and you'd be going through it, and you'd be pointing out these programmatic events that. As you know, as you were funneling through them, the associations that you were beginning to build between the verbal and the visual were just incredible. That it was a real, in my mind, a kind of radical undercutting of some kind of tight fit between form and content, or tight fit between form and program, and that program began to become the illusion, the illusion, the way in which we could begin to invent new combinations of character based on the relationships that we're beginning to build in the drawings. And it's really interesting.
Well, for me, just to build just quickly on that, I've written recently a small piece to do with language prompts and the use of, a lot of people have asked about the use of language. So the conceptual catalysts, for example, little ditties that begin to open up for me conceptual possibilities or program things or the ways in which I will characterize interests. I'll write things in drawings. That are harbingers. They're just intelligences. Language is still precise. I mean, I'm sloppy with it. I'm the worst writer and speaker in the world, probably. But they're still real harbingers of things that really allow me to mobilize different aspects of, whether it's analogic thinking, or whether it's ditties that are prompts or programmatic writing. They just get, the words gather up a lot, and then I try to figure out how to, do they have spatial potential, and if so, how would you work on drawing those things out, spatially or architecturally or materially? I like language. Yeah, I like the use of it in my work a lot. It's helpful for me. Whether it's interesting or important to other people, whether they like the work or interested in it, that's another discussion. But super helpful.
It reminds me, I mean, I'm going to, because of my lecture, I have this fascination with French realism right now. So especially Zola. I've been reading a lot of Zola. And the ability to describe affective states that are not easily named as emotions. Mm-hmm. So an affective state that you can't quite call happy or sad or even melancholy. Mm-hmm. And that you produce those kinds of affects through intense descriptions of events. So like the Belly of Paris is describing the events that are in Les Halles. So to spend 2 pages on describing the different cheeses, it reminds me of how you're describing aspects of your drawings, because there are these insane analogies or these insane characters that get built up by the intense description of combinations of things that cannot be understood as an easily named emotion. And I think that's wonderful.
You just compared Perry's work to Jesus. Did I hear that correctly?
Zola.
And yes?
It's a super nice question. I don't tend to use the word representation myself because of those particular loads that come with it. So I'll use visualizations, imagery, drawing, hybridizations, composites, and so on. I like the question a lot because I've been interested recently in how a spatial realm could sustain its indexical properties, its drawn properties, and its spatial outcomes at the same time. So I'm interested in how a spatial realm might be sort of have mathematical structure, indexical logics, be partly drawing, partly spatial in particular circumstances, depending on what the communicative potentials that I might be after would be. The question about when it stops being representation, I don't think about things representing other things really. Because I'm interested in relational assemblies and relational structure more than I am something representing something else. So for me, it's a little bit, it's less clear when something stops representing something else because I'm trying to cut below the surface a little bit in terms of how to structure communicative potential of certain kind. So I don't know, it's an interesting question. I haven't thought about when representation stops representing.
It's a great question. I would agree. I never think of what I'm working on is not the thing, right? And that's one of the great things I think that we can maybe communicate to students is even though we're talking about representation, the project is where it is when it's in play. And if it's in play in front of you or it's in play at the end of a tractor, it kind of doesn't matter in a lot of ways. It's where it is at that point of time. And so I think it's interesting too where you talked about a drawing that stopped. And that's where it stopped. And that's where it happens to be. I think it also plays nicely against the kind of notion that I know that I, when I'm teaching, really try to beat out of kids is the whole idea of a planned assault for everything. Like, I'm going to think it out, and then I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Which is the problem of the term in a lot of ways, is that it separates the thing from what it is you're trying to do with it. So I feel like, I mean, in our work, it's really clear if you're playing, you're bending a stick and it's bending, right? It's not freedom or hope or any of the rest of it necessarily, but it could sort of bring those things in. And so then I start to think about things like, one of my dirty secrets is I have an Amish Mennonite section of my family. So as I'm dealing with all of these sophisticated tools, I go to grandma's house and she's quilting, right? And I think of the quilt in that way as it's sort of a collage culturally in a way that it's parts of our family's clothing that's going back into a different assembly that then's gonna be appropriated for a different kind of use. So it's sort of a condenser of the family. Like when grandpa died, all the ties were collected and we each got a pillow made of pieces of his ties, which is sort of a beautiful idea and I can't look at it.
Yeah.
Cause it's the thing, right? So there's no separation.
I was actually interested in this moment where you showed this beautiful X-ray, basically one of the last images of your drawings, and the wireframe, because you said that you were. I was really fascinating because somehow it just. I don't know. It's not that it didn't fit, but it was just something that, you know, just, it's like, I don't know, maybe, I'm just asking if somehow it expresses a sort of desire to, it's like creating, I mean, your drawings are really, sorry for the term, thick, in a sense, they are dense, they are just like, you know, they express this kind of overlapping of time, but it's more like, I can see the density in a sense of really materiality. And then I saw the last image, this is X-ray wireframe. Like this. So I'm just very, very, very intrigued from that. And I just would like to know more.
I mean, part of what the question is there for me is just to try to take the same thing and to try to use architectural techniques, representational drawing techniques, to see what kinds of availabilities are by just shifting. Yeah. When you produce the shadows of something, it's different than the wireframe of something. That's the same thing, apparently, but they're producing incredibly different potential. And just part of my interest in trying to figure out what different aspects of representation do and don't do, etymologically, where are they? How do authors interface with them? What is the communicative potential? What do they open up and occlude? So that's part of that, is to just try to take.
It is that really, I don't know, it's like, since your drawings are really dense, it seems like, you know, in theory, you kind of don't need to go further. Everything is somehow condensed there. There is so much richness, there is time, there is history, there is cultural. And so I was just like, I think it's a very beautiful moment. I think it's like really expresses sort of a curiosity that I think it's, you know, from when you arrive to a certain point as a certain caliber, also intellectual property, activity, and so on, I think it's really beautiful to have still this curiosity to use, let's say, even like different, I mean, at the end, different techniques, but in a very, fascinating way. Is this beautiful moment, I think, when the drawings become really generative of something else?
Yeah. You know, just relative to the earlier discussion, I like thinking about drawings that are inspirational. Some are generative, yeah. Some are descriptive, yeah. To really understand that there are very, very different families of representation. Mm-hmm. So this does have to do with keeping my curiosity. What would happen if I got involved in RGB and CMYK and nerves versus vector? Yeah. What would that be?
What would
that
be?
Yeah, I just the pleasures of just advancing a curiosity. Yeah. Seemed like the first, you know, architecture must be generous, and I think you need to have pleasure. Just
so basically, it maybe is not play, but it's curiosity, the right word.
Well, I think it's probably play. Yeah. I think Andrew's prompt is it's probably play. I mean, he's trying to recover being a kid.
Yeah.
Trying to discover a world, just trying to discover what's possible. The drawing sometimes is useful for that.
Yeah.
Well, are there any more questions here, pressing questions? Because we are getting on in time. I'm going to suspend my second more difficult question because we'd be here for much longer. But I'll just let you know what it has to do with the comment. We're not going to answer it.
with what Perry said at the beginning, that he tries to equip his students with the skills for what they're going to need for the next 45 years.
At least.
At least. And we're not...
current medical standards, they could be literally practicing pressure for 60 years easy.
Because that's a beast unto itself. That we're not going to get into that, though. But are there any other questions? Because I want to leave it with you guys before we dismiss. Okay. Yeah.
I have one. Since these things tend to be a sounding board, that's a bit controversial to say.
Go for it.
I graduated 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm. This is a perfect panel to answer that because everyone here is educators and practitioners. Yeah. I'm sorry. Yes. No, that's correct. Yeah. Educators and practitioners.
Well, I think it's the role of a university to investigate new things and put their ideas, even if they are not practical. Maybe nowadays they can become practical. Maybe some of this idea that will be filtered by other problems and so on, but something eventually goes into the profession, maybe in 20 years, in 30 years. But this is the scope of doing workshops, you know, is to put there the issues. Maybe the issues are radically stated in a very strong way, but the interpretation is up to the students, is up to the fellow professor to see what could be taken for your own, even if we work and we have a commission and so on, for your own practice. You know, by looking at the drawings tonight, I realized that there is an idea of architecture that is not just space or walls or colors or, you know, the traditional. There are images. There is a culture that comes from the internet, maybe because this accumulation of images. There is a culture that comes from the colleges of the Bauhaus or Braque or Picasso and so on. There is in architecture, in the building that he expressed, that maybe I would never do a building like this because I don't have that language. But to me, it's much more interesting to see a building in which you have a capital dome sticking out from the ceiling in a way, because it tells me, wait a moment, why is doing that? You know, is that a sign that could become part of the vocabulary of an architect? Maybe not when you do the office for some straightforward company, but maybe if you do a discotheque, you may use that. Or if you do, now I'm saying the discotheque, but I mean something positive, you know, of course. No, but maybe there are places where that is already something established and you can do that. And then from there you go in another realm. You know, when the first abstract art came to play, nobody took care of that. They were considered trash. And then it became part of the chronology of our century, even when the first pop art expressions came into the world, they were considered vulgar stuff, you know, stuff that was not part of the art and anything. And then it slowly it became part of our language, even by more traditional architects, for example, that integrated that into their work. So I understand what you're talking about, but we are not in an office in this moment. We are in a place where the ideas should be put there, and especially ideas that have been really filtered by years of experience, of readings, of looking, and ideas that they are really palimpsest of knowledge. I think all these drawings, they should, you know, it shouldn't take 3 seconds to look at that, you know, it should take 3 hours to look at them. Because every drawing has diagram incredibly complex and dense, and I'd like to see the relationship between the diagram of, I don't know, the path of a star in the sky, and maybe the form of some geological stratas. And there is a relationship. I mean, you suggest to look into these things. So I like, I mean, it's important what you say, and I think it deserves maybe a longer discussion than this. But I think our role is to be really a little bit out there, not all the time here.
I'll say this very quickly. I want to build. That Bauhaus building, we wanted to build that thing, and it was crushing to us to not get it. As a young practitioner, it's actually very difficult. I didn't show yesterday the kitchen remodels and the baby rooms and the carport additions, not because I am somehow ashamed of them, but that's not the argument that I want to put forward in my project that I'm after within architecture. And I just think we sometimes make a mistake in either reducing the discipline of architecture to either the profession or the academy, and we shouldn't do that. It involves both, and it involves a constant negotiation of those. And at least for me, if I'm going to be able to somehow push forward this project, I need to spend most of my energy trying to develop the ideas and the arguments. And the other things that I need to do to pay the rent and do everything else, I'll keep doing them. And we'll do them continually until something begins to happen. And that's a tough thing for a young architect. It's not easy to practice, and it's not easy to make a living practicing architecture and do the things you want to do in that practice of architecture.
You know, I would just add that I think there are real differences between the profession and the discipline. There are considerable points of contact, but there are significant points of difference between what those two projects allow. And I also don't want to negate the parameters of a practice and budgets and costs and so forth, but for me those would simply be, I know the work doesn't look like, you say, hey, you're going to build that. That's $1,000 a square inch for whatever. those aren't even designed yet. Those are like little child's drawings. But I think it's important to understand, for me, that all the variables that one choreographs in a piece of work, just managing the weight and roles that those play. You talked about it, Blair, when you said, you know, we look, here's a given set of things. We look for the cracks and fissures where we can insert and inject insight into that to produce something which interesting, novel, important. But I would also say that if architects aren't producing the conditions, whether representations or spatial realms or whatever, for the cultural imaginary, where the human condition can exercise all of its dimensionalities, who else is going to do that? In the profession, for example, tends to work quite laterally and is not really a cultural project at a certain level. It can't be for lots of good reasons. But as an approach, I still like to think it's a cultural project in the history of ideas, that it belongs, it participates in lots of things, archetypes, paradigmatic logics and structures. Lots of things are at stake in spatial realms. And the profession is organized and cultivated according to certain protocols that don't let it sometimes tip its hat to things that I think are critical. So I'm personally not interested in professional training. My job is to teach the spatial imagination. Then you can go into the profession, you can leverage, you find those moments where you detail in a handrail, and there might be a moment in there where you can really take disciplinary questions and the cultural imagination and say, here's a moment in which I can leverage those skills within a budget and code requirements and clients and so on. But I know it's disheartening sometimes. I get emails from students all over the world now that say, I'm in an office, not doing any of the kinds of things. What do you want me to do now? It's a style of thinking. I don't care that people make strange or unusual or weird things. It's a style of thinking relationally where you can begin to offer a different set of potentials for the human realm. And the profession, I think it's suffocating, to be honest, it's suffocating cultural potential. I teach at a school that announces itself as training professionals, but there are lots of kinds of professionals. It's deciding which profession you want to belong to as part of that discussion as well.
I didn't mean to suggest that.
I didn't hear it that way. Didn't take it that way at all.
No. It's a valid question.
I think that they're a little bit insular from each other, and I think that
totally agree. Architects, totally.
Like Frank Blossom's in World War, he talks about how conceptual or thinking is involved. It's in the practice of architecture, sort of like leaving it out. Suspend disbelief and then begin the project. You suspend disbelief at the beginning of the project. And I think it's a tragedy that there seems to be, or there is at least on a surface level, a disconnect between these two things, because I think they're valuable to one another. And that's just the perception.
Yeah, that's right. I think I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
I think Michael said it best, that it's we're negotiating.
I think it's really finding this moment of negotiation that you were speaking about that could be challenging. At least I speak about my experience. It is like I have a practice in Italy, so I mean it's not like, you know, the most as Andrea can say, the most friendly environment for experimentation, even though we have an history that actually, you know, is supposed to, I mean, it could be supposed to be, like, if you think about our history of great, you know, architect, experimental, and so on. But anyway, I think in my sense, what I try to do, is like to find really this moment that you are calling little moment of negotiation, moment in which, so in each project that I'm doing, at least I try to have a little space that could be really a detail, that could be, you know, like the way, I don't know, the facade is working, that could be, you know, the way that I'm doing, I'm experimenting with materials, for example. And I try to find a moment where I can be, you know, where I can actually find this moment of excitement or of research. And maybe, you know, sometimes you communicate that to the client, sometimes you just make it, you know, more or less not so evident, because of course, I mean, there are a lot of constraints I try to take this constraint, like for example, budget, as something that actually is a positive thing, in a sense that right now it seems to me that with a unlimited budget, we can build whatever we want. We can just make Arup, you know, stand every structure, every crazy structure that we want. So I try to find these little niches where I can actually operate and still be coherent to what, you know, what I like and what I study for. And yes, is tough, but on the other hand, I don't see, I think if we kind of give up the possibility of, as a younger practitioner to, you know, pursue these ideas and our, you know, it just, I don't know, I think it would be really sad in a certain way. And I think drawings, I mean, coming back to the Catalyst agenda, they play a huge role in a way that they are a way of communicating certain things. So, you know, it's like, even like if you have like the most stubborn client, but then you, you know, can be also like a tool that we have. I mean, if we have a drawing that sometimes, you know, I try to say to my student, if you can, if you're able to draw something that, you know, like a person that doesn't know anything about architecture, doesn't know anything about Fayotto, doesn't know anything about what we are doing, but arrives and somehow understand what is happening, or at least get seduced, or at least, you know, is suggesting something, is like, is able to, then maybe, you know, you have, I mean, maybe there is a potential to don't give up. I mean, at least that's what I think.
On that note of encouragement, thank you everyone very much, and thank you Perry again for a wonderful lecture, and thank you guys.